next guest has become the most sought-after, influential activist of her generation, and we are so excited that she can finally join us to give us a scoop on her new book titled State of Emergency: How We Win in the Country We Built. Woo. Please welcome our sister, Tamika D. Mallory.
Oh, yay!
We're so excited to have you.
I'm so happy to be with you all. This is, you know, a dream to me. I know we tried before and it didn't work out, but today I feel like I'm talking to my sisters. So thank you so much for having me.
We love having you.
Yes, absolutely. Well, as you have stated, meaningful change only comes with radical legislation and boots on the ground activism. Now, unfortunately, for various reasons, some people are not interested in participating in elections. So how do you encourage them to vote? How do we encourage people to vote around us?
Well, you know, I've been telling folks that to protest in the streets, because we do a really good job at that. You know, we know how to protest. Yeah. We know how to hit the streets and make our voices heard. But to protest in the streets and not also make sure we're pushing policy, that we're putting elected officials in office that are committed to our agenda, is only doing half the job. It's like we haven't finished the process. You know, get mobilizing and boots on the ground, that brings a certain awareness to an issue. But we ought to have an agenda that includes things that we want to see happen legislatively. And of course, there's, you know, other opportunities for us to work on how in our own communities we can deal with some of our issues without anybody, without police, without, you know, electeds.
That's
we
great.
Need to also be able to build. But every single branch of government, every single institution that operates in our communities should have to respect us. They should understand that, you know, it's our way or no way in our communities. And we pay them. We're the taxpayers. So to be a part of the movement on the street, but not also walk into and use your boots to go into these elected officials' offices and say, hey, I voted for you and I have these expectations. It's like, it's kind of like we're defeating the purpose of one or the other. And so I've been telling folks that I understand there is a real justified reason for people not wanting to be involved in these elections. They don't feel represented. They don't feel respected. And I get it. But it's really that we are not using our vote and our power in the right way. We're only doing a little bit. Maybe that means getting the person elected, but not understanding that the real work is how you go back and force them to do what it is that you feel
that's
that they
right.
should be doing. And that's hard.
Keep their promises.
That's hard.
That's right. That's right.
That's right. Tamika, well, with the current Biden-Harris administration in office, what actions can they take to improve the Black community's quality of life? I really want to get your take on this.
I know that right now we're very concerned with the things that's happening to the Asian community, right? We're very concerned about the attacks against the Asian community. What we also understand is that there has been real work done by our legislative body in Washington, D.C. to try to address it. And that's good. That's what we want to see happen. But the Black community wants to see the same. The Black community wants to see something like the COVID-19 Stop Asian Hate Bill to be passed for our communities. We want to see that there are efforts where you can get nonpartisan support that moves quickly to address issues that have been happening to us for over 400 years since we were brought here to this nation. And I believe that our relationship with the Asian community and any other community needs to be one that is not transactional, that we need to be working together deeply and sitting at the table saying, how can I show up for you? How can I put my body on the line to protect Black lives? Because I truly do believe that if Black people are made whole in this nation, all the rest of the communities here will also be a part of that upliftment.
Absolutely.
And so I just think, you know, we're in a space now where we see it can be done. Let's use the same pressure and keep the same energy from what we've done for the Asian community, for the Black community, and you will begin to see more Black folks feeling like this administration is getting the job done.
Absolutely.
Okay, now speaking of accountability, ex-Minneapolis police officer Derek Chauvin was found guilty on all three charges of killing George Floyd, and a federal grand jury indicted all four former officers involved for the for violating his constitutional civil rights. Now, the video of George gasping for air and continually pleading, "I can't breathe," has been repeatedly shown on the news all over the world. And while the video was crucial, I mean, we understand that, seeing Black lives being murdered over and over again is traumatic. So my question to you, where do we draw the line at being informed and protecting our mental health?
I think we're all suffering from a level of PTSD from watching these videos over and over again. Not just George Floyd, but there's been too many videos. There's almost a video a week. What I fear is that people will become so attached to videos and have become so attached to videos that when there is no video, we're not as actively engaged. We're not as outraged. Mm. We cannot be video activists, yeah, where you have to actually see a man or woman being shot down or being choked to death or something like that in order to feel like you should be involved. What we know is that Derek Chauvin already, he's actually dealing right now with charges for another incident where he kneeled in the neck of another young man, a younger man, by the way. So that means that this has been happening, but you didn't have a video. So now this young man has been waiting, had to wait until George Floyd was murdered in order to get attention to what happened to him when he was abused. That's not okay. That's not acceptable. But what I will say on the mental stress and trauma is that I sat with the family of George Floyd for several days leading up to the verdict. I sat with them towards the end of the trial for several days. We ate together. We talked every day. And the level of anxiety and trauma, not just that they were dealing with, but that Black America and those who care about us as Black people in this country, those people, all of us were kind of sitting on the edge of our chair with this anxiety that should not be. We all saw the video. We know what should have happened. No matter what, we know every single charge Derek Chauvin should have been found guilty of, but we weren't sure. We did not know. We could not say deep down that we were 100% certain that he would be found guilty and that there would be accountability because we have seen this country fail people too many times. That should not be. This family many of them never watched the video. Several of them said they never watched the video. Even I never watched the full video. I don't watch videos anymore because it definitely causes trauma where it keeps me up at night and I can't. And by the way, I get more videos sent to my phone than you will ever see. Just people who are sending me things asking for support. So I stopped watching them and many of his family members said they didn't watch it. But during that trial, they had to sit there and watch it over and over and over again. There was no way to hide. Hearing the sounds playing in court of their loved one's voice, that was extremely, extremely traumatizing for them. And I don't know that they will ever be able to turn that sound off. But the one thing that did happen is that they can go to bed at night knowing that there was a jury of the peers of this nation who said no more. And they did the right thing in that courtroom.